Our world is currently undergoing deep social and environmental change, growing inequality, exhaustion of natural resources, increased pollution. Despite this, responsible practices are heralded as a remedy to the problem, such as recycling and local and ethical consumption. But when we look more closely, is this really where we have the biggest impact on making things better? Have we asked ourselves where the money saved ends up, and what are the impacts of the projects that we finance? In truth, most of the time, we don't have a clue. But now, more and more of us want to understand how our money is used, so that we can be sure it goes towards a more sustainable and ethical society. Have you ever heard the terms responsible finance or responsible saving? Maybe not. Well, responsible finance is a concept that combines financial performance with social and environmental responsibility. Two ideas that have rarely been associated with each other, but are now becoming closely linked. To find out if our money is managed responsibly and contributing to a transition towards a more environmentally sustainable and socially responsible world, let's start by taking a tour of the world of finance. What's the first thing you think of when you hear the word finance? Of course, money. But how do we use this money? Let's take Paul as an example. He works in a restaurant and has been earning a wage since he was 20. Part of his money goes towards paying his living expenses and making sure his daily needs are met. His food, his home, his clothes, and his regular expenses such as water, electricity, gas, insurance, and the rest. With the money left over, Paul has a choice. He can either save it or invest it. To save, Paul has opened a savings account with his bank, and each month he deposits a portion of the money left over after his living expenses have been paid. This amount grows thanks to the interest that it gains. This way, Paul has some capital that he can use later to buy goods, like a car or furniture, acquire services, like a holiday, finance a project, or pay unforeseen expenses. Paul can also invest his money by taking advice from his banker, through an insurance intermediary, on the stock exchange, or through other investment platforms. This way, he can acquire securities, such as shares, bonds, or units of investment funds, life insurance contracts, raw materials, such as gold, artwork, or collectibles, or real estate, a plot of land, a house, a flat that he can live in himself or rent out. By investing, Paul hopes to generate more money. That's what we call the return on investment. But that carries risk, as unlike saving, the value of an investment changes. So Paul could make money, but also lose it. Now let's look at how financial product changes in value. It's at the stock exchange, one of the markets where shares, bonds, and investment funds are negotiated between buyers and sellers, where you can really see how the price of these financial instruments change. These prices vary depending on supply and demand, which in turn depends on internal factors at a company, such as new product launches, opening on new markets, and the impact of social movements like strikes, and external factors, such as changes in the price of raw materials, geopolitical events, analysts' reports, and changes in the interest rate. So these prices are constantly changing, as they are sensitive to a whole host of information that can influence how investors behave, leaving them to either buy or sell their financial products. This is why it's worth doing your research before buying investment products, like Carol did. She took the time to examine these different products with her bank. Carol decides to buy a share in the company Example & Co. A share is a bit like a piece of pie. It is part of the company capital and is represented by an entry in the shareholders' register of the company. Through this purchase, she becomes a shareholder, meaning she owns part of this company. She also contributes to financing its activities. This gives her the right to be paid dividends, if the company issues them, and to be involved in company affairs by voting on decisions at general meetings of shareholders. It's important to note that a share's value varies depending on supply and demand. This is what we call the share price. If more people want to buy a share, the demand, than sell it, the supply, its value increases. So by selling her share for more money than she bought it for, Carol will make a capital gain. In the opposite scenario, she will lose money. After this initial investment, Carol now wants to reduce her investment risk. Although she'll once again invest her money in shares, bonds, or other financial products, this time she'll do it together with other investors in what we call an investment fund. So Carol now has a piece of this fund, but unlike shares, she does not own this piece and cannot influence its general policy. She deems this less risky, because unlike a share, which is a single financial product, an investment fund allows her to invest in several different financial products. This is known as diversification. What's more, Carol's risk is shared with the other investors. Now let's look at Example & Co., the company that Carol has invested in. This company needs money to finance its activities. To do this, it issues bonds by inviting investors to lend it some money in exchange for a certificate. Unlike a loan that you take out at a bank, this certificate can be negotiated on the financial markets. Carol sees the chance to invest again, so she buys a bond from the company Example & Co., meaning she is lending money to this company. In exchange, the company promises to repay her the money, then, after a certain period of time, to pay her an additional amount known as a coupon. Thanks to this investment, Example & Co. can borrow money without needing to take out a bank loan. And Carol, in addition to getting her money back plus the coupon, can sell this bond on the market to another investor, meaning she can get her money back before the scheduled date. For Carol and Paul, their bank has pointed them in the right direction by determining their investor profile thanks to a highly detailed questionnaire. Beyond advising them, their bank offers them the usual services. It collects and holds its clients' money. It offers them a range of payment methods, and it can lend them money just like it does to companies. So the bank is the intermediary between depositors and borrowers. Depositors deposit their money into their savings accounts. This money is then available to the bank. In exchange, the depositors receive earnings on this amount, known as interest. Borrowers ask the bank for a loan to help with an investment or to finance an item, such as a house or a car. They then pay a fee, known as interest, for this money to be made available to them.
Find all episodes on the ABBL's YouTube channel. Responsible Finance, the finance of tomorrow.